Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good and his mercy endureth forever. We want to thank and praise God for you tuning in with us here at Christian Ministries of the Apostolic Faith Church for Easter morning celebration. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. And I want to welcome you here. I'm Suffragan Bishop-elect Pastor Frankie L. Quinn, lead pastor here. And we thank God for our lovely wife, Tracy Quinn. Thank you, Lord. And we thank God for all of our many members here at Christian Ministries. And we thank God for our praise and worship team that are here on today to bring you a song of Zion to uplift the name of Jesus. And right now, we want to go before the Lord in prayer. We want to remember men and women and children everywhere that the Lord will save and add to the church daily such as should be saved. And after they bring you a selection, then I'll be bringing forth the word of God. So pray for me also that you grant the door of utterance. And let us pray for our praise and our worship team that it will elevate your spirit, get you in the mood. And you can stand with them at home. You can clap with them at home and give God glory, give God honor, give God praise. Amen. The scripture says where two or three are gathered together in his name, touching and agreeing, he'll be in the midst. And that doesn't mean that we have to physically be together, because we can touch and agree over these internet waves and things like that through social media. There's many ways to touch and agree. Thank you, Lord. So let us pray. Gracious Father, in the name of Jesus, we come before you, Lord. We just say thank you and praise you for your grace, your mercy, your love, and your kindness. We thank you for the anointing. We thank you for the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And Lord, we magnify you. And Lord, as we move forward in this service, Lord, we ask you to touch, we ask you to deliver. We ask you to set the captive free in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you, fair glory, and we praise you. Thank you, Lord, and give you glory and honor in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
Amen. We want to say happy Easter. Hallelujah. God, we just thank you for the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, what can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And what can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Singing, gold precious is that flow that makes me white as snow. And no
It still has its power. It still has its power. Thank you, Lord. And we thank the Lord for the blood that was shed for us on Calvary. We weren't redeemed by the blood of bulls and goats and of heifers, but we were redeemed by the precious blood of Jesus. And right now we want to thank God for our praise and our worship team. And they pressed their way out on today, this Easter Sunday, to bring you an A selection. I hope sometime or another before it's all over, they'll bring you a B selection. Thank you, Lord. Certainly, I have to confess that when I woke up this morning, my heart was heavy because we wouldn't have services as normal. And I'm one that I feed off the saints. I love being in the congregation. I love seeing people praise and worship God. I love seeing people give God glory and honor. And today we would have various testimonies about the precious blood of Jesus and how special the Lord is. Amen. Thank you, Lord. But I had to work through my little feelings and emotions. Thank you, Jesus, and come to a conclusion that this is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. So I'm supposing if I had to work through my little feelings, I'm sure that you had to work through your little feelings too. Thank you, Lord. But as we know that this too shall pass, there's going to come a time where we'll all get together. Thank you, Lord. And we'll sing and shout the victory. I'm really looking for a day when we open up the church doors again and we'll be able all to come together. And I'm gonna tell my congregation now, y'all got to forgive me. I'm gonna be like David, I'm gonna dance. Thank you, Lord, I'm gonna shout and I'm gonna give God glory. And the thought came to my mind, say, Pastor, you got to forgive us too, because we gonna give God glory as well. Amen, so we certainly do thank God. We thank God for his word. And on even on this special day, this special occasion, because he has risen. And I won't be before you long on today, but I want you to turn with me to the book of Acts chapter number 1. And I want to just encourage the saints to give unto the Lord. We do have e-giving, which is tithely. Just download the app if you haven't already. Find Christian Ministries of Erie, PA, and follow the instructions, and you can give that way. You can also mail in your tithes and your offerings. We have received some that way as well. And we also have a drop box, which is locked. Amen. And you can come by the church and drop in your tithes and your offerings. It's good to give unto the Lord. The church still needs to pay its bills and things such as that. And we do trust in the Lord. And I don't want you to miss out on your blessings as well, because the Lord loves a cheerful giver. And he said that in his scriptures that he would open you up a window and pour you out blessings that you don't have room enough to receive. So I want you to turn with me once again, I know I've said it, to the book of Acts. Acts chapter number 1. And I just want to read to you a couple verses of scripture from that particular chapter. It says, the former treaties have I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and teach, until the day in which he was taken up, after that he through the Holy Ghost had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen. And verse number 3 is going to be our focus verse for this morning. To whom also he showed himself alive after his passions by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. Let us pray. O gracious Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for the hearers and the doers of your word. We thank you for the anointing that you have set in this house. We thank you for those, Lord, that are there, that are listening unto us, even over the airways. We ask you, Lord, that you're blessed by your power, through your anointing, grant the door of utterance. Lord, let your word permeate our hearts and bless us and strengthen us and heal the few sick among us. We believe in your power. We believe in your deliverance. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. And I just want to invite your attention to that verse, a scripture in Acts chapter number 1 and verse number 3. It says, and after, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. And my subject for today, I want to talk to you about after his passions. After his passions. After his passions, he showed himself alive by many infallible proofs, being seen of them, notice, 40 days, and speaking of the kingdom of God. Jesus not only came and he rose and he died, but he got up. He got up from the cross, from the grave. And from there, the scripture says that he showed himself alive. And it's important that people know and understand that Jesus endured the cross, that he endured the suffering, he endured the pain, and from there, he got up. He got up from the grave. And that's the basis of our salvation. Nobody has ever seen death, endured death, and got up from death, and has ascended and seated at the right hand of God but Jesus. Many claim to have been the Savior of the world, but only Jesus is the one who not only claimed it, but he performs even unto day many miracles, signs, and wonders illustrating that he is the Christ. And I just want to talk today about the suffering of Jesus. Jesus suffered on Calvary, and he also suffered in a place called Gethsemane. And in that garden of Gethsemane, which means an oil press. And in that garden, it was at the foot of Mount Jerusalem, called the Mount of Olives. And there they would press olives there to make olive oil. And it was there where Jesus prayed. He prayed in that garden. And he prayed in agony. And it was there in that garden where he was betrayed by Judas Iscariot. And it was there in that garden that he prayed, and he was betrayed by Judas Iscariot. And the very next day he was crucified, hung on that cross. And it was apparent that Jesus chose to be, as the scripture says, to agonize in a garden as such, that it was in the garden that we were sold out our sins. We remember the garden of Adam and Eve. It was there, the place of the original sin. And it was symbolic that Jesus would go to a garden to suffer for us, for our sins. And he there was agonizing. Was in that garden where Adam and Eve were tempted of the devil. Thank you, Lord. And it was there that Jesus, in a garden, the garden of Gethsemane, he prayed and he agonized. And the Bible says that he was pressed out of measure. And the Bible says that sweat ran down his face like great drops of blood. And he prayed and said, "Father, if there be any other way, remove this cup." But he said, "Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done." So him being under extreme pressure, thank you, Lord, and that sweat represented his atoning blood. He was pressed out of measure. That's why that place is called the olive press. It represented the anointing and the atoning blood of Jesus. And Jesus suffered in that garden. Don't fool yourself. He suffered and he agonized because he knew that he was about to die for the sins of the world, that he would be the Lamb of God who the sins of the world would be placed upon. And being in agony, he prayed and he went through some emotions and he went through some spiritual turmoil for you and I. Hallelujah, to bring his flesh under subjection, to bring his mind under subjection, to get him ready for what he was about to do. Y'all know the story that even his disciples, they were there with him, but a sleep spirit came upon them. And Jesus told them, he said, "Can't you just pray with me for an hour?" Hallelujah, pray with me for an hour. At least you enter into temptation. And it's good to listen to Jesus, because when the thieves came to steal Jesus, I call it, the security guard, Peter whipped out his sword and cut off the ear of Malchus. But Jesus was in the right spirit. He picked up the ear and laid hands on the individual. Thank you, Lord, and replaced his ear. My God, Jesus was in the saving business. And then Jesus, from there, they took him, the Bible says, from judgment from prison to judgment. And they took him to a place where on the Bible says called Calvary. And the scripture says that it's a place that was called Golgotha, which is meaning the skull. And it was there on Calvary that Jesus was beat beyond recognition. Isaiah said his very visage was marred. I was marred so that people would not even recognize that he is the Christ, that this was an individual that could survive death. And as Jesus suffered, the scripture said he suffered among two thieves, one on his left hand and one on his right hand. And the one that was on one hand, he was there trying to rebuke Jesus in the sense of saying that if you are the Christ, if you are who you say you are, save us and save yourself. And that individual represented an individual who wanted to be saved without confessing their sins, wanted to be saved without judgment. And there's a lot of people that are in the world today that want to be saved without confessing their sins, want to be saved without really having faith and confidence in Jesus. But I like the response of the individual on the other hand. The one on the other side, he rebuked the malefactor or the thief that first was trying to rebuke Jesus and said that this man is a just man. We are the ones that are sinners. And he simply asked Jesus, he said, Lord, when you come into your kingdom, remember me. My friend, that's the way we ought to be saved. We ought to confess our sins and confess that Jesus is the Christ. And notice what Jesus said. Jesus told him that today, this day, ye shall be with me in paradise. Hallelujah. And that scripture was written to fulfill the scripture what was written in the book of Isaiah. In the book of Isaiah, it said that he would be numbered among the transgressors. And that's what Jesus was. He was numbered among those thieves, the transgressors. And the one that believed on Jesus, my Lord, he immediately went into paradise with Jesus. My God, and the Bible says Jesus was saving on the cross. And he said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. And I love that particular scripture about Jesus in the sense that he being on the cross, I like to say that he stopped dying to care for somebody else that was dying. He stopped thinking about himself, and he thought about others that were needing salvation and deliverance. He's a wonderful Savior. He's a wonderful deliverer. Thank you, Lord. And Jesus, he gave up his life. The Bible said he died, my Lord. And when he died, the veil of the temple was ripped in twain. When he died, he gave up the ghost. The Bible says that the sun refused to shine from 12 o'clock noon till 3 p.m. That 3 p.m. represented the time of the sacrifice, where the sacrifice was to be offered up. And then he was buried in a borrowed tomb. And the Bible says that when Jesus died, there were also earthquakes. And there were also people that rose from the grave that were walking around Jerusalem. My God, something happened. And I remember the scriptures that said that when he died, there was a centurion that was standing by after they had pierced him in the side. And out came water and out came blood. That centurion said when he saw Jesus had died, surely, my Lord, this was the Son of God. Surely, this was the Son of God. But I'm so glad that this is not the end of the story. My Lord, not only did he die, but the Bible declares that he got up. He got up from the grave. But before he got up from the grave, the scripture says that he descended into hell. And he preached. He preached the gospel. He preached the good news to the justified souls that were in hell, so that they could be freed and so that they can understand, hallelujah, that their fasting and that their prayers were not in vain. My friend, you've got to understand that your fasting and prayers are not in vain. And that when he descended into hell, so to speak, no doubt he saw Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. No doubt he saw Moses, Daniel, and the prophets. No doubt he saw all of them who offered up sacrifices unto God, expecting deliverance, expecting salvation. That's why the scripture says that these all died in hope, having not yet seen the promise. The book of Hebrews brings that out. And what promise were they talking about? They died in hope, believing in the Messiah, but the Messiah hadn't manifested himself in their lifetime. But they died hoping. They died trusting in the Lord. Hallelujah. That's what Paul was referring to when he said that we shall not prevent them that are asleep. Hallelujah. Because if you're going to die, you got to die trusting in the Lord. If you're going to die, you got to die with a hope that lies beyond the grave. And that hope is in Jesus. That hope has to be in the Savior. And that Savior is Jesus Christ. And you know, what I love about the Word of God is that God, He doesn't forget your labor of love. He doesn't forget your confidence and your faith that you put toward His name. And Jesus, I can imagine their eyes getting light and their eyes opening up in hell and rejoicing over the fact that the Lamb of God that was slain before the foundation of the world came to take their souls out of hell. And the Bible says that He led captivity captive. My God, and gave good gifts unto men. In other words, when he came up out that grave, he out of the pit of hell, He captured all of those that trusted and that believed in Him. He got those that had confidence in Him. Thank you, Lord, to take them to a place of paradise, my Lord. So after Jesus, my God, had suffered, and after He had died, and after He got up on the third day, the Bible says that after His suffering, that first day of the week, Simon Peter, and John, they ran to the tomb to see Jesus. After Mary Magdalene and her crew had went there to anoint the body of Jesus. And when they had gotten there, they saw that a stone was rolled over the tomb. And Mary ran to Peter and John and said, "Hey, I need you to come and roll away the tomb because I want to anoint His body." And the Bible, in the book of John, it says that Peter and John ran to the tomb, and when they got there, they went down into the tomb. And when they went down into the tomb, they didn't see anybody. They saw that Jesus' grave clothes, they were folded up neatly. Hallelujah. That shows you something about cleanliness. It's next to godliness. But Jesus folded up His clothes to show us that He wasn't in a hurry. Hallelujah. That He had no fear. Thank you, Lord. And put His clothes together. But He was risen. And the scripture says that John, he believed, but Peter yet had some doubts. Peter yet had some doubts about whether or not Jesus had risen. And this is the reason why Jesus would show Himself alive. Because oftentimes His disciples had some doubts and had some questions in their minds. So Jesus, Mary Magdalene came to the garden and she found out that Jesus was gone. And the Bible says she begins to weep and she heard who she's supposed to be, the gardener, calling out, and she said, "If you have borne Him or laid Him hence, tell me where you have laid Him." And then Jesus called on her name and said, "Mary." And she looked and turned around and she said, "Rabboni," which is meaning Master. And Jesus said, "Don't touch me, because I have not yet ascended to my Father. But go tell my disciples, go tell them that I have risen, that I'm going to ascend to my Father and to your Father. I'm going to ascend to my God and to your God." And the Bible says that Mary, Magdalene ran and went and told the disciples all that she had seen. And Jesus, Hallelujah. No doubt, then again appeared unto them. Hallelujah. He appeared unto them again. And he was showing himself alive. And there was one when he had appeared. Thomas, doubting Thomas, he was not there when Jesus had appeared. And he said, unless I thrust my hand in his side and see the nail prints in his hand, I won't believe. And then as soon as he had spoken these words, Jesus showed up. Hallelujah. He showed up and he said unto him, he said, thrust your hand into my side. Thrust your hands into the nail print of my hand and see that it is I. And Jesus encouraged them. And then the Bible says he breathed on them and told them to receive ye the Holy Ghost. Jesus was showing himself alive. And after his passions or after his suffering, he appeared unto them again. The Bible says he appeared unto all the 11, all those that were left. And when they saw him in Galilee, the Bible says they begin to worship him. Hallelujah. I couldn't imagine in my own mind. They begin to worship him. Hallelujah. Jesus showed up. My God, he appeared unto them in Galilee. And Jesus told them, he said, all power, my God, all power in heaven and in earth has been given unto me. Imagine that statement. Jesus was telling them that he had all power, hallelujah, in heaven and in earth. It was given unto them, hallelujah. He was encouraging their hearts to let them to know that I am he that was dead, but now I am alive. At one appearance, Jesus showed himself, hallelujah, and they were cooking fish, and Jesus showed up, and he ate fish with them, proving that a spirit have not flesh and bone. Jesus showed himself alive. And then when Jesus showed himself alive to the 11, he gave them commandment. He told them to go and preach this gospel, baptizing in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Ghost. And they understood Jesus because they baptized on the day of Pentecost in the name of Jesus, for the remission of his sins. The name that the Father gave is Jesus. The name of the Son is Jesus. And the Holy Ghost comes back in his name. So they baptized in that name. Hallelujah. Everything that you do in word and deed, you got to do it all in the name. There's power in the name. You know, it strikes me funny. My God, I just want to do a side check here. It strikes me funny that people want to pray in his name. They want to give in his name, but they don't want to baptize in his name. In other words, they want to do everything. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Except baptized in the name of Jesus. And that's what Jesus was saying. He was saying, thank you, Lord, baptized in the name of Jesus for the remission or for the forgiveness and for the removal of one sin. And then he told him, because he was thinking about the kingdom, he told them to teach them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. In other words, teach the principles of the kingdom. Teach the word that I have placed down inside of you. My God, what makes a kingdom is teaching. What makes a kingdom is the word. What makes the kingdom is the laws of God. And we have to obey God's laws. We have to obey God's word to be a part of the kingdom. So Jesus said to them, and I love this part. He said, I'll be with you always, even to the end of the world. What Jesus was saying was that I'm giving you power. Power to tread upon serpents. Power to tread upon scorpions. Power to lay hands on the sick so that they can recover. I'm giving you power to preach my word. I'm giving you power to stand in the gap. Thank you, Lord. And he said that I'm going to be with you even unto the end of the world. What end of the world was he talking about? He was talking about the end of the church age. The church age began in the book of Acts. Hallelujah. It began with Jesus after he had shown himself for 40 days and for 40 nights, teaching and preaching concerning and pertaining to the things that be of the kingdom of God. And he told his disciples, I want you to go and to tarry and to tarry in Jerusalem. And I want you there to wait until you be endowed with power from on high. And then his disciples asked him a question. They asked him a question and said, Lord, at that time will you restore the kingdom of heaven? And Jesus said that it's not for you to know the times or the seasons wherein God has placed in his own power. But he said that ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And notice, he said, and ye shall be witnesses of me in Jerusalem, in Judea, and Samaria, and on the uttermost parts of the world. Notice, after they received the gift of the Holy Ghost, after they received power, they were to become witnesses of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. They would become witnesses of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And that's why Jesus, he showed himself alive, because he prayed in the book of St. John, John chapter 17. I'm starting to feel my help coming up on here now. Thank you, Lord. In the book of St. John chapter 17, that's where Jesus begins to pray. Pray before his death. And he prayed. He said, Father, glorify thy son with the glory that I had with thee before the world began. And he begins to pray, and he begins to pray for his apostles that they would go out and be one even as he is one. He said, I haven't lost any except for the son of perdition, who was literally Judas Iscariot, the one that betrayed the Christ. And he said, I have kept them all. Hallelujah. That's why when Peter reached out that sword and cut off the ear of Malchus, Jesus picked it up and put it back on his head, because he didn't want Peter to go to jail with a murder on his case. He didn't want Peter to go to jail with an assault on his face. Hallelujah. So Jesus, he made all things new. That's where we get to say Jesus dropped the charges. Hallelujah. He is the one that keeps us alive. He is the one that keeps us from going into the deeper depths and greater amounts of sin and shame. It is Jesus. If Jesus be for you, who then can be against you? My Lord, so we see here in the scriptures, it was Jesus, when he begins to pray for his disciples, he begins to pray for the apostles. And then he said this, which is very important. He said, Lord, I not only pray for them, but I pray for them that which were going to believe on them through their word. And we believe on Jesus through the apostles' doctrine. For what the apostles taught, that's what we believe. And that's what keeps us saved. So therefore, that's the reason why Jesus, he had to show himself alive. That's why Jesus had to show himself alive to his apostles 40 days, thank you, Lord, before his ascension up into heaven. He had to guarantee and make sure they knew that it was he that was dead and he that was alive. He had to open up their understanding of the word that he had taught them throughout his three-year lifetime with them, that Christ should suffer, that he should die. It behooved him to suffer and die and to get up on the third day, and that repentance and remissions of sin should be preached in his name. And it wasn't until then that they begin to understand and to understand what the life of Jesus, what he taught and what he preached. And they needed to understand. You remember the scripture when Jesus said to them,
Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And they were all confused. And they said, some say that thou art the prophet. Some say that thou art one of those other men. But he said, who do you say that I, the Son of Man, am? And it was revealed to Peter and said that thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus said, upon this rock, I'm going to build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And then I love it when Jesus said after that, he said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. My God, we've got to know who Jesus is. We've got to know that he is the Son of God with power. We've got to know that he is the one that is able to keep us from falling. And not only, thank you, Lord, he had to teach it to his disciples, but they had to know it, because they would be the ones that would lay a foundation. And that foundation would they lay is no other than Jesus Christ. They had to lay a foundation that Jesus is the Christ. And they would know that when they started preaching Jesus, when they started doing miracles, signs, and wonders in the name of Jesus, that they would be crucified, that some would be beheaded, that some would even die, that some would be even thrown in the lion's den. But they had to be steadfast. They had to be unmovable. They had to know in whom they believe and whom they trust. My brothers and sisters, today is the day where we've got to know in whom we trust. We've got to know in whom we believe. That's why Paul said, I am persuaded. Are you persuaded today? Hallelujah. That not death, no life, no hell, no angel, no principality, no power can separate you from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. And because of their testimony, because of what the apostles have gone through, we believe on them, hallelujah, that have wrote the scriptures about the suffering of Jesus Christ. My Lord, we've got to come to understand, brothers and sisters, in my conclusion here, hallelujah, that Jesus is the Christ. You've got to understand that not only did he die for you, but he got up from the grave. And that power in knowing about the resurrected Savior, that power in knowing about the resurrected deliverer. The scripture says, if Christ be not risen, then our preaching is in vain. If Christ be not risen, then our living is in vain. If Christ be not risen, then our fasting is in vain. And the scripture says, and ye are yet in your sins. But now is Christ risen from the dead. Now is Jesus risen from the dead and become the first fruits of all them that slept. In other words, he alone has become the captain of our salvation. He alone has gone through the portals of death, hell, and the grave, snatched the power and the authority from the devil, hallelujah, and is seated up on high. Hallelujah. He alone led captivity captive and gave good gifts unto men. Hallelujah. Death came by one man. Hallelujah. And certainly did life come by the Jesus Christ. Death came by one man, and the resurrection from the dead came by one man. All died in Adam, but all are made alive in Jesus Christ. My God, death could not keep them in the ground. Death could not hold them in the ground. So I tell you today that after his suffering, after his resurrection, after he got up from the grave, my Lord, some things transpired. After he got up, he snatched the keys from death, hell, and the grave. After his suffering, it looked like he was going out. Hallelujah. But if they had known, thank you, Lord, about what was going to happen, they wouldn't have crucified the Lord of glory. But he suffered for us. And the Bible says that his suffering was not in vain. His testing trials were not in vain. After after he suffered, my Lord, he gained us freedom from our sin and shame. After he suffered, my Lord, he bore our griefs and he carried our sorrows. After his suffering, the Bible says that he was elevated and he sat down at the right hand of God, expecting all of his enemies to be made his footstool. After his suffering, the Bible says, who shall declare his generation? Who shall lift him up? Who shall magnify the name of the Lord? Jesus suffered. Jesus died to show himself alive. He showed himself alive that we might believe. Believe what? That Jesus is the Christ. Hallelujah. That Jesus is the Savior. That Jesus is the Deliverer. And that believing you might have eternal life. Jesus died for you so that you can have life and that more abundantly. Jesus died for you so that you can live, so that you can face tomorrow. Jesus got up from the grave because he was obedient and it was commanded that he should die his way, but it was impossible that the day that the grave should hold him. It was impossible that death should keep him in the ground. And he got up, hallelujah, so that we might believe. And if we believe in him, if we trust in him, we can have eternal life. And if you have known him, hallelujah, if he has risen in your life, you've got to tell it. You've got to tell somebody, hallelujah, about the risen Savior. You can't hold it and keep it to yourself. It's just like fire shut up in your bones. After you have suffered with Jesus, after you have tasted of his glory, you've got to magnify the name of the Lord. And he said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the day of believing on him. Today is the day that we should trust in the Lord. The Bible says, trust in the Lord and do good, and verily shalt thou dwell in the land. Jesus suffered. Hallelujah. He suffered for you. Jesus gave his life as a ransom for you. The scripture says that he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. And the chastisement of our peace is laid upon him. And with his stripes, we are healed. Healed from coronavirus. Healed from sickness and diseases. Healed from evil thoughts and evil deeds and evil ways. There's something about the name of Jesus. There's power in the name of Jesus. And who shall declare his generation? Do you believe on the apostles? Do you believe what was written? If you believe what was written and you believe on the apostles, you've got to declare, hallelujah, that he's alive. Where is he alive? He's alive in me. Is he alive in you? I can feel him in my hands. I can feel him in my feet. I can feel the Lord all over me. And not only is it a feeling, I can live this thing. Hallelujah. I can trust in the Lord. I can do what he said do, because he has given us power. Power to live right. Power to do right. Power to be right. Because he suffered. And not only because he suffered, because he died and gave up the ghost, but he lives. He got up. He lives again. And that, my friend, is the message for today. Hallelujah. You've got to understand, thank you, Lord, that the sufferings of Christ, hallelujah, he suffered and he's showing himself alive even unto today. Hallelujah. If I hadn't seen it with my own eyes, the power of Jesus and the lifestyle of a man that lived next door to me, I would have known that he lives. If I didn't see in the lifestyle of the man that lived next door to me, I wouldn't know that Jesus could deliver. I wouldn't have known that Jesus could set an individual free, because it was in my time of need. It was in my time a want and desire to change my life, that the Lord caused me to see an individual that lived next door to me, and I was there on my bed of affliction. And I said, Lord, help me. I said, Lord, I know that there is a better way. And because my neighbor next door, he believed on the apostles. He believed in the word that God had put in his heart. And not only did he believe it, but he lived it before me. And it gave me an opportunity to cry out, Lord, I want to be saved. I want to be delivered. And because of his lifestyle, he caused me to believe, hallelujah, to believe on the Savior, to believe on the Deliverer. And because of our lifestyle, because of our lifestyle, we have to believe that Jesus is the Christ. He is the Son of God. So go out, tell it on the mountain. Go out and live this thing to the best of your ability. Hallelujah. Not in your own might, not in your own strength, but in the power of the Holy Ghost. Let your light shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. Live this thing, because there are a lot of people that are dying. They never know that Jesus lives. Where does he live? He lives in me. He lives in you. Where does Jesus reside? Hallelujah. He resides in my heart. He resides in my mind. And everything I do, everything I go, I do it in the name. I do it in the name. I do it in the name. I do it in the name of Jesus. Oh, my friend, clap your hands and give God a praise. Let us magnify the name of the Lord. After his suffering, he showed himself alive. Hallelujah. And if there's anyone out there today that needs prayer, my God, just bow your head with me and we can pray. And if you want to be baptized in the name of Jesus, hallelujah. If you want to be baptized in the name of Jesus, just hit me in the inbox and I'll make sure you're baptized in his name. Hallelujah. And if you not only stop there, but be filled with the precious gift of the Holy Ghost. The scripture says that ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. There's something about the power that is in Jesus. There's something about deliverance that is in Jesus. And if you want to be delivered, you can have your sins washed away, but you also have to gain a renewed mind, a renewed strength. And a renewed mind and renewed strength comes through his Spirit. The kingdom has to come. The kingdom doesn't come in meat and drink, but in power, righteousness, and in the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost brings you the kingdom. Ah, and that kingdom dwelleth in you. And then you can live right. Your mind can be transformed. Your mind can be renewed. You have joy unspeakable and full of glory. You can have trouble all around you, but you'll still have a peace that passes all understanding. Hallelujah. You become his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, prepared unto good works. Don't let his suffering be in vain. Hallelujah. Don't let his suffering be in vain. Don't let his humiliation be in vain. He put a crown of thorns on his head. Hallelujah. They spit upon him. They took off his clothes. My Lord, in that day, that was the high form, the highest form of humiliation. But just hung him on the cross with a linen cloth around his privates. That was the highest form of humiliation that they could do unto him. Hallelujah. And they mocked him. Thank you, Lord. They spit upon him. They put a sign up on his cross and said that he's the King of the Jews. And they wanted everybody to know. They put it in Hebrew. They put it in Latin. And they put it in Greek. Thank you, Lord. So that everybody would know that this man here said he was the King of the Jews. They didn't know how true it was. My Lord. They didn't know how true of a statement that was. Thank you, Lord. Jesus is the King. But it doesn't matter if he's the King, if he's not your King. Doesn't matter if he's the Lord, if he's not your Lord. That's what matters. He has to be your Lord. He has to be the king of your life. And the only way for him to be the king of your life, you've got to repent. You've got to repent of all of your sins. Don't be like the one thief on the cross. Go back and read it. He was self-righteous. He told Jesus that if you be the Christ, save us and save yourself. He wanted to get in without repentance. But the other thief, he rebuked him. He said that, hey, leave this just man alone. We deserve to be on the cross. We deserve to be on the cross. Not Jesus. He did no sin. But he became a sin offering for us. We deserve it. Not Jesus. Then he turned to Jesus after his confession of sin and confessing that Jesus is the Christ. He said, Lord, let me be with you in your kingdom. My Lord. And sometime I wish I was that fellow. That way I don't have to suffer nothing. Thank you, Lord. Jesus turned to him and said, today you're going to be with me in paradise. Hallelujah. Today you can be with Jesus in paradise if you put your hope and your confidence in him. Don't let his suffering be in vain. He has risen. He is the resurrection. He is the life. He that believeth in him, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Jesus' disciples, I'm trying to close up in here, but I feel a tugging in my spirit. Jesus' apostles had to know that he lived. Thank you, Lord, because they were going to lay a foundation for which we ought to believe. And so that's why Jesus showed himself alive. Those 40 days, he ate with them. He talked with them. He appeared unto them. Hallelujah. And showed himself. He even went fishing with them. When I read that, I was like, wow. He went fishing with them. That time when Peter caught all those fish, that was after Jesus' resurrection. My Lord, he fished with them. And then he continued to talk to them about the kingdom. Hallelujah. That was Jesus' only message. Preaching message about the kingdom. He said, don't you know I got to be about my Father's business? It's all about the kingdom. Thank you, Lord. And the kingdom has come. He said, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. We thank God for you today. Hallelujah. We thank God for this message and for this word that you have heard on today. And we pray that something was said or done to encourage you and to inspire you. And you can do nothing else. You can go out and spread this message. Tell somebody that he is risen, that he is the Savior, that he is the Deliverer. And not only tell them, but show them by your lifestyle that Jesus is the Christ, that he is the Lord. So go tell it on the mountain. Hallelujah. Go tell it everywhere you go that Jesus Christ is Lord. We thank God for you. I'm trying to close here again. Thank you, Lord. But I want you to tune in with us on this coming Wednesday at 6 o'clock for our Bible study. Thank you, Jesus. And hopefully, I know that the Lord is going to give us a word and to encourage you, to inspire your heart. My God. Hallelujah. And once again, call somebody, visit somebody, talk to somebody. There's people that say that, we didn't know Pastor Quinn was doing Facebook and all this, but we sent out information. We sent out texts. Thank you, Lord. So make sure that people get in touch with other people to tell them. Amen. We are our brother's keeper. This too shall pass, and let us love and support one another. Remember that our vision is to be a caring church, leading souls to Christ, strengthening members and families, making disciples, equipping them for service and community ministry. And let us remember that our job is to promote the gospel of Jesus Christ through responsible and effective ministry and intentional, creative, dynamic fellowship. Let us live out our morals, that we love one another. Amen? That we'll be patient, that we'll be persistent, that we'll sacrifice, and that we'll serve. Now is the time to show to show who you are. And not only that, but shows whose you are. Be committed. Be committed to Jesus. Serve him in the beauty of holiness. Amen. Because he's soon to come. These are the last days. My Lord, these are the last days. I don't know when he's coming. Thank you, Lord. But I know that his coming is drawing nigh. So get yourself ready. Abide in him. Abide in his word. And trust in the Lord. Trust in the Lord. Trust in the Lord. And be encouraged. Be encouraged. Be encouraged. Be encouraged. I want to pray for you. And I thank God for you. In Jesus' name, pray for the pastor. I love you. God bless you.